Alright, a very good evening to all of you. Now you might be thinking that why am I uploading videos on PhD in Germany? I have already uploaded two videos for which you will find the link over here. You can just click the I button and watch both the videos. So this is the third video on how to get a PhD in Germany. And the reason why I am making it is because the more data points you have, the better you can predict something, right? The more data points you have, the better your graph is, the more accurate your graph is. Similarly, when you have more data points, you can better predict the toxicology of a drug, or you can better predict an activity of a drug. So more the data points, the better it is. Similar is the case over here. If you have more idea as to what, see, everybody has a different journey. All three have a different journey on how they got a PhD. None of them have the same journey. So from them, you will get a data point as to what were the things that they did. You can find out what were the common things among all the three. And you can build your profile in a better way. So this is the advantage. So now, without wasting any time, let's dive into the interview. So hi Shilpa, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm good. And currently, I have given an introduction about yourself. So you can give you a brief idea about the learners, that what you are doing currently and a little bit about yourself.
Okay, so my name is Shilpa and I come from Kerala. So I did my bachelor's and master's in ISA Bhopal, and then I applied for PhD positions, and I'm currently doing my PhD at Forschung Centrum Jülich, which is a research institute, which is part of Helmholtz group in Germany. So I started my PhD work in last September. So I'll be completing my 1 year in September 2020. So basically I'm doing my PhD in soft matter, experimental soft matter, which is kind of more into biophysical chemistry. Right. So I'm just getting into my work at the moment, not completely.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Nice. So I wanted to actually, this question came up in previous interview videos also. So I've done two interview videos of two aspirants or two research fellows who are doing their PhD in Germany. So this is going to be the third one. And I got a very common query that, what exactly is the stipend that you get as a research fellow over there, and like who sponsors that stipend? So can you give an idea to the
Sure. So this fellowship actually varies from institute to institute, so you can't generalize between institutes, but more or less it will be something between 1500 euros 2000 euros in between that range. The gross, there will be taxes that will be reduced, but after that you will get something around this.
Right.
So so this is the salary you get, and what was the other one? Sorry.
Who funds it basically? Generally?
So for me, in case the funding comes directly from my institute, from Forschung Centrum. So in most cases it comes directly from the institute. But in some cases, there are like other funding agencies like EU, the Science Union for EU, some other funding agencies which funds, but mostly it comes directly from the institutes.
Okay. So, And is there any particular reason why you chose to do PhD in Germany over, let's say, other European countries, or in particular, I would say in comparison to US? Because US is a very, very popular destination to do a PhD.
Yeah. So one thing is, of course, the duration. I didn't want to, so in US, it's like 5 years.
Right.
So I didn't want to spend so much years. That was one thing.
Right.
And that was one of the main things why I chose Europe for PhD. And there are very good institutes in Europe, actually. Okay. So it was more or less okay for me. Yeah.
Right. And there is, I've heard, you could actually acknowledge that. In Germany and in European countries in general, you would not see coursework, which is there in US-based institutes.
Yes, I mean, there are no mandatory courseworks. But so I was having a bit of bad luck in that case, because I was having an Indian degree.
Okay.
And that was not equivalent to the MSc offered by the university. So I had to take another course to make the equivalent credits.
Okay.
But in general, there are no coursework. So that is also a good thing, because you don't have to spend a lot of time in repeating the courses that you once did from India.
Okay.
So you can directly...
Since you did BSMS, that's why it was not considered as an MSc? Or if someone does BSc, MSc from India, even then they have to go through the coursework procedure?
I think it depends on the number of credits you completed during your MSc. So they were saying I was lacking some credits in my chemistry department. So they wanted me to repeat one course so that I complete that credits. But like I haven't heard from someone else. I think it was just for my case.
Okay.
Sometimes I've heard when you change the department, suppose you did your master's in chemistry from India and now you're joining for PhD in physics or something, then you might have to take courses because you're completely changing the department.
Oh, okay. So yeah, there's a provision that someone from a chemistry background can get into a physics department and get a physics
PhD. Yeah, sure. So it's like basically which department your professor is affiliated with.
Okay, that's interesting.
So I have friends who has done pure science degree from India, but when they came here, the professor is affiliated with chemical engineering department. So then they have to now register in chemical engineering department. So sometimes they have to take courses.
Okay, right. Yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah.
And so apart from Germany or apart from the university that you're currently associated with, did you apply to any other research institutes also across Europe?
Yeah, in fact, I was applying to a pretty much PhD positions because we are not really sure which one we would get through. So which all positions were matching with my research interest and I had interest to work with, I was applying, and some I had to give few other interviews as well. Okay. But finally I chose to stay with this one because this was closely matching with my research interest.
Okay, great.
So I thought I'll grow with this.
Right. And after your MS, did you take a break of a year or something, or did you?
No. I completed my MS in June, around June, and then I joined for my PhD in September. I did not take a break.
Okay. And any particular reason why you did not plan to pursue it from India, PhD from India?
PhD from India. First of all, I wanted to have a different exposure because I did my 5-year bachelor's and master's and my master thesis in India. So I wanted to know how is it different, and I wanted to have a different exposure. And the same thing in India as well, duration is a bit long. So that's why I chose to be.
And I heard that professors at ICER Bhopal, they kind of encourage their master's and master students to go and do PhD abroad.
Yeah, my professor. So I was working with Professor Saptarshi Mukherjee at spectroscopy lab for
he's
my master's thesis.
Right now, if I'm not wrong. He's a dean of ICER Bhopal.
Right? He's a deputy director of ICER Bhopal.
Okay.
Yeah. So I was working with him and he was really supportive. He was really encouraging me to apply. If I have interest, he was telling me to apply for PhD. Because, when I was working in ICER Bhopal, we actually have an idea about how research goes in India.
Right.
So I had an exposure to that. So now he encouraged me to go outside, go a bit broad and have a more broad research exposure.
Right. Okay.
Shilpa,
can you give a detailed insight onto the application procedure for someone who is looking to start from scratch? So first of all, just your experience, how it was, and what are the factors that you feel are going to be important, in your application, which you should focus on or emphasize on when you're applying.
Mm-hmm. So as you said, I literally started from the scratch. I had no idea of how to apply, how to start with. So the first thing I did was I inquired with a lot of seniors who already applied. So they would give us an idea about how it works, when should you start applying, what are the things you should take care of. So there are basically, when you are applying, I'm not a good person to tell you how to apply in US or Canada because I haven't done that. So when you apply for PhD positions in Europe or in particular in Germany, so either you could directly mail them asking for a PhD position, so which most of them doesn't reply because they consider it as spam mails that they get every day. So that is one way, or either you could apply through the graduate schools, which most of the universities have.
Right.
So in general, what I chose was there are different websites like Nature Career, Find a PhD, where they post the PhD positions, vacant PhD positions. So from my personal experience, I think that is the best way to have more chances of acceptance, because those are PhD positions that they offer and they are looking for candidates.
So you tell them it is not considered as a spam, they kind of like have a look at your application.
Exactly. So you are applying for a position that is vacant.
Right.
But when you just ask general for a PhD position, it's like a normal mail.
Right, right. So rather than blindly mailing everyone, you should see that whosoever has a vacant position with them and then try and apply accordingly.
Exactly, exactly. So, okay. I mean, most of the positions are posted in these sites. So,
one small thing that could you just send me the links to these websites so that I can post it?
Sure. So, I'll send you the links. So, there are different sub websites like that where you can sort out depending on your interest.
Okay.
So, you can sort out, filter out which countries you want to work with, which areas you want to work with. So, they will show you the positions fitting into your criteria, and you have a deep look into it. They will give probably the project description, the salary package, everything.
Okay.
So then they in general ask for your CV, your statement of purpose, your transcript, if you have completed your master's certificate, and all of those certificates.
Exactly.
So I think the main thing that affects your application is for sure your statement of purpose.
Okay.
From my personal experience, I mean, marks, yeah, to a bit it affects, but if you have a decent grades, I think it's how you did your master thesis, how you have explained your research interest in your SOP. So what I did was I took a lot of effort and time in preparing the SOP.
Okay.
Reading it, correcting it again before sending.
Give you a little bit of detail as to what is to be written, because some of the candidates don't have the idea as to what they have to really describe in the SOP. So could you just give a
So my SOP, so before doing my master thesis, I had done 3 internships before. Was not really the same field, but different fields. So in my SOP, I actually first explained a brief introduction about myself, and then I categorized my research internships that I have done into 3 different categories, and I explained what are the expertise I gained from doing these internships.
Right.
And then finally, I explained a bit about my master thesis, how I came into this field and how it made me interesting to pursue research in this field.
Right.
And then why I'm this is a portion which is very important, I think. Why am I fit for this position? Why I should convince them that I am fit for this position.
Right.
So explain why, how did I got interest into this? What all you can expect from me? So all of those things. And it's like more or less 2 pages. That's it. But you have to maximum, I would say, expose yourself.
Basically, make them describe yourself to the best possible manner.
Exactly. So they should feel by reading your SOP that this is the best candidate that I can get into. But that doesn't mean putting a lot of lies. But I mean,
experience, your experience throughout.
Exactly. Our research experience, what we have expertise in, what we are good at. I mean, it could be scientific writing, presentations, whatever it is.
Is it supposed to be only about scientific achievements or scientific experiences, or it could be also about general experiences? For example, someone is good at, let's say, maybe at a particular sport, they can describe that as well?
I won't say in a long length, in very much length, but yeah, in 1 or 2 sentences, that would work, I guess.
Okay. But majority of it would be related to a scientific experience.
Exactly. So that's what they are looking for.
Right.
I mean, you can also include that you are a team person, you are okay with working as a group.
Right.
All those things can be included, but the focus should be on your scientific background.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So SOP and your CV is something that you can attach.
Yeah. So CV, I mean, I guess most of them, there are different websites which helps you in making CV,
right,
like CV Maker or LaTeX, whatever. I made my CV in LaTeX, I guess. So that will have a professional look. So that's why, rather than making it simply into Word, it would be better to make in some professional sites.
Okay. One is CV Maker and the other one is
LaTeX. So that is kind of, I won't say it's a programming. It's kind of, you have the template, you just have to input your data and you get your CV.
Okay. So it basically gives you the process format. Basically.
Yeah, exactly. So there is already a written template. You just have to give in your data so that you get your CV based on that template.
Okay, excellent, excellent, right.
Yeah, so then there is your CV and SOP. And the other thing which I don't think is very important, but which some graduate schools like Max Planck sometimes ask, is your TOEFL score.
Okay.
So, which I had given my TOEFL exam. So, which is, I would say it's a plus, but it's not compulsory.
Okay, got it.
So,
basically, it's like for those of you who don't know, TOEFL is basically an English proficiency examination, which exactly, basically yeah, gives you an idea of, like, gives the professors an idea of how, like, what is your command over English, basically.
Yeah, yeah. Well, how good you are at English. So, right, that's not compulsory, but I think in some universities in UK, it's compulsory when you apply for UK. But in Europe in general, it's not compulsory. So it's just a plus if you have it.
Okay, right.
Yeah. And so basically, and then, yeah, if you have some publications for your master thesis, that's definitely a plus.
So you have any?
My first publication from my master thesis has been submitted. So it's under review now.
But currently, when you were applying, at that time, you did not have the publication, right?
So then when I was applying, I was writing my publication. Okay. So my professor had mentioned that in his recommendation letter that I was writing my publication. So it would be good if you have one.
Right.
But it's not mandatory. But I mean, for sure, if you have a publication, it's a plus.
So if I want to, if somebody is applying, is it fair to say that your research experience, not the publications, that you should have some kind of research experience in the field that you're planning to apply? And secondly, you should have decent grades. Like, are these two things important?
Yes, yes, yes. Because one thing that I feel in Europe is the duration is quite low. It's like mostly from 3 to 4 years. So for my contract, it's for 3 years, but some places they have it for 4 years.
Okay.
So the thing is, the professors or the supervisors that take us, they don't want us to come here and study the techniques. Okay. I mean, some basic techniques, not everything, but some, like, if so, when my professor is looking for someone, she would look someone who has an experience in chemistry lab, not someone who's doing chemistry for the first time when she comes here.
Right. So basically, even if they have to be taught, it would be like they'll understand or they'll like pick up in a shorter span of time.
Yes. I mean, they would be taught techniques that they're not completely aware with, like very new techniques, but not the basic solution preparations. I mean, I can say from a chemistry perspective, some basic chemistry techniques, you know. Okay. Yeah. So that would be so it would be best if you have some research experience and a good grades, as you said, a decent grades. Yeah.
Okay. Even though it's a very subjective thing, but what would you consider decent grades? Like, what is the
range? Yeah. I mean, I don't know if I can say.
You can give your opinion. It's not something that is hard and fast.
Yeah, I think. If I can say in a CGPA scale, I think above 8 could be a decent grade.
Okay.
But there are, I know a lot of people who has less than that, but still got into a very good position. So I don't say if someone has less than it, no, for sure he or she can get into a good position.
But it's always favorable to have a good grade.
Yeah. I mean, it's for sure. It's good that you have a backup.
Right.
If you have a bit of less research experience or you don't have so much experience in labs, but you have a very good grades, it could help you.
And I think vice versa, if you don't have good grades, but you have a lot of research experience, so that
experience also, that will also favor you for sure. Okay. Yeah.
Right.
If you have a good publication or, but you still have a low grades, it would favor you for sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
So like continuing, you mailed through various sources.
Yeah. Yeah. I mailed through various sources and then I applied through some portals, the graduate schools, like Max Planck has their positions, like some fixed amount of positions that they put forward every year, or I think in every 6 months as well sometimes. And then the Helmholtz as well has some other like graduate schools. And then I mailed through these vacant positions I saw. And through the vacant position, sometimes you get a reply that it has already been filled or some other candidate has been taken. Sometimes you get a positive reply. Go forward for an interview. So it all depends on how, you know, how crowded the applications are or how much people have applied to that. So it all depends on that. But Yeah.
So it's basically an online face-to-face interview?
Yes, online face-to-face.
This is the second step. So the first step is
you apply. So in some cases, sometimes for Max Planck and Helmholtz, they ask you to come to Germany or some other place for the interview sometimes.
Okay.
After the first round of online interview, you have a face-to-face interview in person.
Right. So basically the first procedure is that you apply, then you get a favorable call saying that let's have an online interview. Then you have an online interview, and then in some cases they call you for a face-to-face postal interview also at Germany. In some cases.
At Germany, where you might have to present your master thesis, what you have done in front of a committee, and they finally decide.
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
So, and others directly kind of evaluate your profile from the online interview.
Yeah. They generally they take an interview where you discuss about your master thesis. They discuss about their PhD project that they are putting forward, and kind of a general discussion, not really an interview that I had at least. Okay. It's just a discussion, scientific discussion. And then they look into your recommendation letters, how good the recommendation letters are. And on the basis of that, they take a final decision. In general, this is the procedure.
Okay, right. So what was the procedure that you faced for getting?
Okay, So the procedure that I faced was I applied through the graduate school. So there is this International Helmholtz Research School for biophysics, which is Biosoft. Right. So I applied through the graduate school. So the convener of the graduate school, if he finds that the student or the candidate is fit for some PhD positions that they have to offer, they would evaluate our application and they forward it to the faculties or the supervisors. And if some of the supervisors find, okay, she or he is suitable for my position, they would contact you further.
Okay, right.
Yeah. So and the good thing about...
They will have their own procedure of shortlisting you?
Yes, but the good thing about the graduate school that I applied through was they don't have a deadline. You can apply anytime throughout the year.
Oh, okay. That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. So then the applications are evaluated in the every first Wednesday of every month.
Right.
And if they are not for going forward with your application, they say you would get a negative response. But in case if they are going forward, you wouldn't get a response from the next Wednesday, the next month's Wednesday that you have applied.
Okay. So roughly it takes about, so you'll get a reply irrespective of whether you have been shortlisted or not within 1 month. Is that fair to say?
No, not really. If you're not shortlisted, you would get a reply within 1 month.
Okay. So basically someone can be positive. They have not got a reply within 1 month.
Yeah. But I don't know because whether they reply negative to everyone, I'm not really sure, but that's what they say in general.
Right.
And then, yeah, they forwarded my application to different faculties and my current professor, her name is Simone. So she had a PhD position, which was vacant that time, which was more or less matching with my research background. So she contacted me further. She directly contacted me asking if I am interested in her position, giving all the details, what the project descriptions and everything. So I found it interesting. And then, so then she asked for a Skype discussion. So then we had a Skype discussion. So basically there I had to explain about my master thesis, what all things I did, how I did my calculations and all of those. Generally, I have to explain my master thesis and they would ask some doubts if they have any after the presentation. And then she explained about the PhD project that she is putting forward, what she is expecting from me, what all things I would be bound to do, and what all are the difficulties that I might have to face, and what are the administrative procedures, all of those general stuffs. Okay. All of those things she explained me, and then she said she'll let me know a decision within 1 week.
Okay.
Yeah, that was the only interview I had, but some of my friends had two rounds of interviews. Were they shortlist from the first round and then again a second round of interview? So it all depends on your supervisor.
I think it also depends upon the number of applications. So if they have
exactly. So if if the supervisor feels there are a lot of good candidates, he might have to take several rounds of interviews.
Right.
But if it's for my case, it was just one round of interview.
Right.
And then within 2 days, she let me know that she would like to accept me as a PhD student. Yeah.
So the questions are only based upon your project, or there were some basic questions also related to, let's say, some basic concepts in biophysical chemistry?
For my case, I can say it was just based on my master's thesis. She wanted to know more about my research experiences, more than my chemistry. So she is basically a physics professor. Her background is physics. So she wanted someone whom can support her in chemistry.
Okay.
So she can give the physics contribution. So she wanted someone who can give the chemistry contributions.
Okay, that's interesting. So you will be getting a degree in physics, or you will be
in chemistry itself.
Okay.
But her background, her background is more into physics, and mine is more into chemistry. So she wanted to club it with together.
That's a good fit, basically. So
you will have an interdisciplinary field to work with. That's what she said when I had my interview. But I've heard also cases. So I had another interview where they basically asked, more of chemistry questions.
Okay. And where was that, if you don't mind?
It was in Czech Republic.
Okay. Right.
Yeah.
So the same procedure you applied.
It was a vacant position.
You mailed to the professor directly.
I mailed to them, and then they shortlisted the candidates, and then we had an interview.
Okay, and there the questions were based on more into on the basic aspects of chemistry.
Yes, because they were like chemistry professors, so it was more into the basic aspects. How much? It was more like to test the knowledge that you have in chemistry.
Okay, so they did not ask you many questions from your thesis, is it?
Not really. Yeah.
Okay. So. But I think I have taken two interviews before as well. So in those cases also, they were mostly interested in your research experience rather than your concepts of chemistry.
Yes, I think it's the thing
in Germany in general that they ask you questions related to research experience. But that's good to know that in some countries, they do ask questions based on basic concepts of...
Some places they do, but in general, I think they're more focused on your research experience. What you have done before, more or less based on that.
So are these the only two interviews that you faced, or there were many others as well?
I got interview calls before, but then by then I fixed this position, so I didn't go for the other ones.
Okay, right. So there are two questions that I had. First was that if someone, when did you actually start your, once you decided that you want to do a PhD abroad, so when did you start shortlisting universities, and when did you, when did the procedure start off for you?
So I think I was not really sure if I wanted to do a PhD till my fourth year of my BSMS, because then till then I had short internship experiences, but not more than that. So by internship experience, you don't really get to know more into research. I think I was pretty sure that I wanted to do PhD only after I started my master thesis. So once I started working on my master thesis, I started working on my master thesis around May 2019.
Okay.
So around June, I started shortlisting my PhD positions, but I didn't start applying because by then I had nothing to show as my research experience from my master thesis. So I wanted to have a bit of data or analysis that I have done so that it can back up my application.
Right.
So I started applying for positions, I think by December or something.
Okay.
Around November, December. Yeah. When I had to submit my 6-month report of my master thesis so that I have some backup for my application. So then I started seriously applying for the, before that, even I did spam the professors with direct emails. Do you have a PhD position? But to be honest, none of that worked out. Okay. So a very serious application.
They don't reply at all, or they just put in a short message saying that we are...
Most of them replied, few of them replied that there are no vacant positions. Contact us in this time or this time. Yeah.
So basically you think according to you, I would say that what you're suggesting is it's more or less futile to directly apply. It makes more sense to apply to someone who already has a vacancy.
Exactly. So, I mean, when you directly apply to a position or you directly ask the professor whether you have a position, it's like they have to find a funding for you, first of all.
Right.
So, I mean, if you are not so fitting, none of the professors would take so much effort to find a funding for you.
Okay.
So it's basically better, I think, to directly apply to a position rather than to just spam the professors with emails.
Okay. Why didn't you consider like the Dad Fellowship? For that, basically, you need acceptance from the professor first before actually applying.
Yes. I actually tried for that, but the point was I was a bit late. So I didn't get a confirmation before the deadline for the Dad Fellowship.
Okay. So yeah. I think in that cases, it makes sense to apply to professors who even don't have a position, because once you get the acceptance, then only you can apply for the fellowship.
Okay, but I'm not really sure about this. I don't know how much correct about this, but I've heard from my friends that Dad Fellowships, or even once from a professor, I got a reply where I mailed him asking for a position so that I can apply for the Dad Fellowship. So what he said was the fellowship, the amount of Dad Fellowship is a bit low to survive in the Germany. So even if you have a Dad Fellowship, the professor need to support you with some other funding so that you can, it's a good salary.
Okay.
So if Dad provides you like some part of the funding, but in general, professors ask you to find some other funding as well. So in general, if you even say to professors, I would like to apply for a separate fellowship so that you just accept me so that I will apply for a separate fellowship. Professors are not really interested because the fellowship is quite low. And I mean, if you are not financially stable, that would also affect your work.
Okay, got it.
So I just once got a reply from a professor like that. So I'm not really sure. But Dad Fellowship, there are a lot of people who apply for Dad Fellowship as well.
Okay. So, yeah. Since you talked about the stipend is not sufficient. So obviously it depends upon the place you are staying in, because if your university or if your institute is situated in a rural setting, then obviously the expenses would be comparatively lesser as compared to urban setting.
Yes, for sure. But so, there are some like standard expenses that you have for sure, like your rent and like your food things, which is more. The rent would vary from village to city. But the supermarket expenses or the general expenses that you have is more or less stable all over the Germany.
Okay. So if someone is financially a little, you can say, from a humble background, and they want to they want to have some savings. So is that a possibility that you can have a decent standard of living and end up saving some money?
Yeah, sure. I think you can. If you have a fairly good salary, like the amount that I told in the beginning, around 1,500 to 2,000 euros, I think you will have a good savings.
Okay. Yeah. In your opinion, how much is it reasonable to say that you can save this much amount?
Euros? Sorry?
200 to 300 euros, is it possible?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I mean the general experience, the general expenses you will have is like your rent you're giving, and the food expenses. If you're cooking food or you're having food from canteen, all those expenses. So these are the general expenses that you'll have every month.
Okay.
But rest is upon person to person. So I think you can have a good amount of savings.
Okay. And what about someone who like how have you traveled throughout Europe?
Yeah, I used to travel, but now because of the situation, everything is halted for the moment. Yeah. So this is also a good experience to have new exposure to different cities, new cultures. I think it's a very good experience. I used to travel before.
And I think the best part is that it's more like the countries over there are like states in India. Like
it's like very convenient to travel. Even the flights are really cheap to go from one country to another. It's really cheap. So, yeah, I mean, but still, I think if you give out some amount of money for your travel as well, I think you will have savings.
Okay, that's good to know. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it all depends on person to person. Yeah.
Right. So, thanks, Shilpa. Thank you so much for your time. One last question I had for you.
Yeah, sure.
That is that what is the difference that you find now that you have experience of India and a sufficient experience in Germany? What are the some key differences that you find in the research culture in Germany and India?
So the research culture, so basically,
like one striking feature that you found that it is really different.
So something in that India, I was working with a big group where there were like 5 or 6 PhD students, there will be a master's student, so there will be some research associates. So obviously when you have a big group, the time that the professor can give for each individual student is less because you have a big group and the professor of course has to take care of each and everyone. So the time that you will get to discuss with your professor will be a bit low compared to here. So here, if you ask about my group, it's just me, my professor and a postdoc. It's just 3 of us.
Okay.
So it's like most of the day I have discussions with my professor. I can tell her what I have done, what I've got, what is to be done next. So it's like I get a lot of more time to have discussion with, which I think as a master's student, it was okay for me in India because I was just doing a 1-year thesis. So it was more or less okay. And I had PhD students to support me. The PhD who were in the lab, they were really supportive for me.
Okay.
But when you're doing your PhD, you're all alone. You have to take care of your thesis. You have to understand everything. So it's good to have a solid support from your professor. That's what I feel at least. Mm-hmm. So I think here I'm getting a lot of time to discuss with my professor everything. I think in that aspect, it's good to have a very small group. Okay. But then you don't have any colleagues to ask questions or discuss something. That is another, not bad, I would say, but that is another aspect of this, the same thing, because it's a very small group.
Okay.
Yeah, and then...
What's the mindset of... is there any change in the mindset of the students or the professors?
In India, it's student and professor. And in Germany, it's colleagues. So that would make a difference for sure.
Right. So I was more emphasizing on the culture in, like in India, publications are given it plays a very strong part, or it is emphasized a lot, like publications are important. So is that the same that is observed in Germany also? Like are publications given that much importance?
Not really, actually.
Okay.
I won't say it's not given importance, but I don't know if it's as much as it's given in India.
Okay. Right.
So here you have a fixed time for working. I mean, it's like 9 to 5 or 9 to 6. You can work more after that, but most of them work from 9 to 6 or 9 to 5 and try to complete the work within that time. And then you have a lot of leisure time to, recreate or have more of.
And I think even weekends are also off, right?
Exactly. So Saturdays and Sundays are off. So if you want to go for a trip or you have time, and then there are vacations you have. So for me, it's like 30 holidays per year. I can take to a maximum of 30 holidays per year.
Okay.
So it's like
they try to be more efficient and
within the limited time. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So it sounds all good from here. So are there any disadvantages, anything that any negatives that you also have? Because right now, as you kind of like conveyed, it looks all like I can't find any kind of.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want to find a negative because then it would be difficult to survive here if I find something negative because I'm all alone here. Okay. So I don't want to find something negative. But yeah, I mean, for sure, you're living in an entirely different country where it's like, where you have no connection with people, culture, everything.
Right.
So from the day one, it took me a lot of time to adjust to this culture shock that I had for the first few months.
Right.
Everything is different. People are different. So, yeah, I mean,
I think Indians are there everywhere. So you might have found some.
Yeah, there are a lot of Indians, actually. For sure, you find Indians everywhere. That is for sure. Wherever you go, you will find for someone for sure. But that's true. But yeah, but you yourself will have a culture shock at first because you are coming to a place that is completely different for you.
Mm-hmm.
And the languages, you don't know German. You don't know, and most of them speaks only German. When you go to a shop or to a supermarket, you want to ask them something, but they're not able to converse in your language and you are not able to converse in their language. And then you have to take this Google Translator wherever you go. So it was quite a bit difficult at first.
Right.
At some points you feel low, for sure you will feel low because you're doing PhD, you have a lot of pressure and then you have on one side this culture differences and on other side your work problems. So yeah, at some point you will feel low for sure, but then this was your choice. No one asked me to do PhD.
Yeah, exactly. But I think more or less, I think the advantages, like we discussed, these kind of like really lift you up and, you know, like push you to complete your PhD over here or make your life better at least.
Yeah. I mean, this, I am here by my choice. No one asked me to. So it's my, like my, it was my choice. So I have to adjust with what all comes in that way. So yeah, okay. I think it's more or less okay.
Now, have you picked up German? Bit.
Not really. I mean, I'm doing my A2 now. So okay. I completed A1. So like really, really little words, but I'm doing my A2 now. So okay. It's quite difficult. So it takes a lot of time actually.
Right. Yeah. So I think that was a very fruitful discussion. And thank you, Shilpa.
Thank you so much for having me.
Definitely. I think this discussion is going to be really helpful for the students. And in case if you're okay with that, I will maybe put down your email ID if someone wants to.
Sure. Yeah, sure.
Okay.
For sure. No problem.
For them.
Yeah, sure.
Again, thank you so much for helping out the learners over here.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Hey guys, so I'm a verified educator on Unacademy. And along with that, I'm also available on the Unacademy Plus platform where I'm taking live classes along with other educators. So in case you're interested in attending the live classes, you can subscribe to the Unacademy Plus platform using my referral code, that is SETHI, SETI, and that will give you 10% discount, all right? And in case you're not interested in attending the live classes, you can watch the free courses that are available on the Unacademy. For that, all you need to do is go to the Unacademy website or download the Unacademy Learning app and search my name over there, that is ACT. Once you do that, you will get the access to all the free courses that are available on the Unacademy platform.